I'm pleased to be here. It is my great pleasure. Thank you for organizers, and I would like to congratulate, and I'm happy that this morning session is so very well attended. So this is very important for the meeting. I just heard from Dario that my talk is the only one talk which will be related to hypertension. So, and the hypertension is the most important. As you could see from the previous speaker, ischemic heart disease and stroke are the most important causes of death today. And the hypertension is the most important risk factor for both. For stroke, for ischemic heart disease, for heart failure, for chronic kidney disease. And what is hypertension? This is just one rhetoric question, but many times we forgot that hypertension is not only high blood pressure. And as you can see here, hypertension is effect syndrome. And I like to say the hypertension and diabetes are brother and sister. And they have two bad parents. One is obesity, the other one is chronic stress. And this is the whole story. So you can see here, hypertension is the first among equal. Then we have dyslipidemia, insulin resistance, in the background of both diabetes and hypertension. And then visceral obesity. This is truly the most important, very probably secondary cause of hypertension. We know the mechanisms of hypertension related to visceral obesity, and we know how this might be prevented and how it should be treated. Then sympathetic overactivity and increased renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system activity. Then impaired kidney function, that means just slightly decreased GFR and increased albuminuria. They all contributed to increased cardiovascular risk and are related to hypertension and their causes of hypertension. Then we have vascular remodeling, several defects in iron membrane transportance, then defects in coagulation, and endothelial dysfunction. And this is the topic of my talk, and I will speak a little bit more about endothelial dysfunction and how could endothelial dysfunction be improved or saved during our life and prevented for onset of hypertension. So this is just a memento. What are the basic functions of endothelial? It is really important from vascular structure. It is included in cell growth regulation, coagulation, immunity, and inflammation. It controls blood cells adherence, control of permeability. And this is the one of the reasons increased permeability is one of the reasons why albuminuria is not only a sign of chronic kidney disease or impaired renal function, but also of overall endothelial dysfunction. And then metabolic activation, primary oxidation. So this is the balance between contraction and relaxation, proliferation and growth inhibition in the steady state. And we all know that various hormones and peptides are involved in this regulation. The most important are very probably those components of renin angiotensin system. But then we have also some others. And here are also some hormones that have vasodilatory properties. So hypertension, diabetes, obesity, dyslipidemia, smoking, hyperhomocysteinemia, and increased fibrogen are related to endothelial dysfunction and all cause turbulent blood flow. So there are no shear stress on the endothelial cells, there is turbulent blood flow, and in that case, there is vasoconstriction and cell proliferation, overgrowth, relaxation, and growth inhibition, and this is the beginning of cardiovascular, cardiorenal, or cardiometabolic continuum. So endothelial function is related to vasoconstriction, to thrombosis, to atherosclerosis, and then at the end of the cardiovascular continuum also to restenosis. So sustained normal endothelial function is therapeutic goal or should be therapeutic goal and should be the goal already during the prevention. So what are the strategies for improvement of endothelial function? The first one is physical activity. We are human beings, we have to move. Then nutrition, vitamins and all others. Then L-arginine, as NO donor. This is just the proof of the principle, how it should be and how it works. Then quit smoking. Then RAS inhibition, inhibition of renin angiotensin aldosterone system, and normalization of lipid, not only hypercholesterolemia, but dyslipidemia. So what about physical activity and endothelial function? So it is interesting that increased physical activity increases expression of genes related to NO production, but also decreases activity of RAS, of renin angiotensin aldosterone system. There is reduced activity of angiotensin converted enzyme, and there is also decreased AC gene expression. So this is in fact the explanation how physical activity has beneficial effect on endothelial function and leads to vasodilatation and decrease of blood pressure. So in that case, there is more relaxation and less contraction. What about ACE inhibitors? The drugs which blocks RAS activity, interestingly, they have the similar activity of endothelial as physical activity. They decrease synthesis of angiotensin 2, but also of endothelin 1. They increase NO production, and they also increase production of bradykinin, and this is also the component that leads to more vasodilatation and lower blood pressure. So the same as with physical activity. What about the other group of antihypertensive drug, calcium channel blockers? They have also some effects beyond blocking calcium channels, in fact, increasing NO production and leading to vasodilatation beyond calcium channel blockade. So because of that, they lower blood pressure, but they also retard atherosclerotic process. So this is just a summary. Effects of endothelium, regardless this is achieved by physical activity, by food, I will speak a little bit more later on, or by drugs, increase NO endothelium leads to relaxation of vascular smooth cells and consequently decrease of blood pressure. So what are strategies to increase NO signaling in cardiovascular diseases? So you are much more familiar than me in this. So there are two ways. One is this, much more liked by many of us, by fruit, chocolate, and particularly red wine, which are rich with polyphenols, and then fruits and vegetables rich with NO donors, with nitrite, bringing them to nitrite, and then at the end to NO. And here is one of the masters of this sitting in the first row, Professor Vuksanov. So you are very well informed about these mechanisms, how it's translated from nitrite to nitrite and then to NO, and when they are in the bloods, they have all beneficial effects on endothelium. But we have also here little helpers in gut, our microbiota, which is helping and bringing much more NO, and later you will see also some other gases into our blood, which have beneficial effects on cardiovascular system. So could the food actually decrease blood pressure? Is there some evidence-based? Because we have to treat our patients with evidence-based facts and evidence-based medicine. This is a pyramid study published last year. And you are aware about new guidelines of American Heart Society and the new definition of hypertension. And in fact, all who has blood pressure above 130 over 80 is hypertensive. In the past, we called this pre-hypertensives. And we could treat all pre-hypertensives or hypertensives today with drugs. And then the question is whether we can treat them effectively with some other ways. And this is one way how maybe we treat pre-hypertensives or nowadays in America, stage one of hypertension. This is polypill for pre-hypertension, but polypill not made from drugs, but polypill made, as you can see here, from various substances of many plants. And the first one here is garlic. And you can see here significant decrease of systolic and diastolic blood pressure in those subjects with pre-hypertensions, treated with polyfill for pre-hypertension. So this is nothing new, because in the past it was proposed to use polymeal instead of polypill. And you can see here percentage of reduction in cardiovascular risk. So it's significant with wine, with fish, with dark chocolate, with fruit and vegetables, particularly those rich with nitrites, garlic, almonds, and combined effect is pretty significant. So, but the question is whether this is truly feasible, and who can afford this, and what will be adherence for this, what is the cost, and where is the final evidence-based medicine for this that we can use it safely in our patients. With high-risk patients, with those with hypertension, which is the killer number one in the world today. And there is the other bad parent. One is obesity, the other one is chronic sympathetic overactivity. And what is the role of NO related to sympathetic overactivity in pathogenesis of hypertension? So we know that sympathetic overactivity has two faces. One is good, the other one is bad. The ones particularly in the past, at the beginning of the human story at the Earth, it was beneficial. It was acute, it was needed for the fight or flight decision, fast making, and then it saved lives. Now, when we are exposed to chronic oversympathetic activity, it is related to increased cardiovascular risk and to deaths, and now it is bad. So how could, or how can, or how acute sympathetic overactivity increases vasodilatation and increases, in fact, NO production? It's shown here. So increases ENOS activity. On the other hand, the bad component, the bad side, the bad phase is chronic beta adrenergic activation. Then there is ENOS uncoupled. Uncoupled ENOS, much more oxidative stress, and at the end, endothelial dysfunction. So chronic stress, sympathetic overactivity, oxidative stress, and at the end, endothelial dysfunction. So how can we treat this with drugs? Can we, is simply NO delivering enough? Or maybe it might be bad in the chronic stress. More NO, more uncoupled NOs, more oxidative stress. So now we have some drugs which might decrease sympathetic overactivity. The most famous are beta blockers. But if you look now in the guidelines, recent guidelines of American Heart Association, of European Society of Cardiology and Hypertension, beta blockers are no longer drugs number one. They should be treated only in patients with hypertension and already suffered MI or stroke or heart failure. Can we use alpha blockers? There is no evidence. We know they are, let's say, prohibited even 10 years ago, but we are still using them. What about central antihypertensive drugs which have sympatholytic activity, central sympatholytic activity? There is no enough evidence base. So, but we know that beta blockers are not the same. There are some differences in beta blockers in this class of antihypertensive drugs. So this is beta blocker, which is particularly interesting when we are speaking and talking about endothelial function. This is nebivolol. Here you can see atenolol, propranolol, carvedilol, the old-fashioned beta blockers, and this is nebivolol. And nebivolol has two isomers, L and D. And this D-nebivolol isomer is related to classical beta blocker effects. But this one, the L-nebivolol, it determines the stimulation of ENOS. And this is related to the cases and to the results reported with nebivolol with endothelial-dependent vasodilatation. So this is the classical, and this is the part of nebivolol which acts directly on endothelium and increases NO synthesis. Are there any evidence about this? Yes, and you can see here data in healthy male subjects and in patients with primary hypertension, and you can see here significant difference between nebivolol and atenolol in vasodilatation in healthy subjects. In patients with hypertension, they make a further step, and you can see here again significant difference between nebivolol and atenolol, but then when L-NMA is added, that means less NO could be produced, this effect was abolished. Furthermore, there is enhanced acetylcholine-dependent endothelial vasodilatation with nebivolol. This is endothelial vasodilatation. And this is also important. There are data reported here that nebivolol inhibits superoxide production. That means it reduces oxidative stress. You can see here superoxide radicals. This is control. This is without superoxide radicals. And you can see here dose-dependent reduction of oxidative stress with nebivolol and no, in fact, with other beta blockers, atenolol and metoprolol. So this is the same for those who like more cartoons. So nebivolol has two properties. One is the classical beta blocker, and the other one is effects on NO and endothelial vasodilatation. But the other important feature of nebivolol is selectivity. It is highly beta-1 selective beta blocker. But there is something more, there's something beyond in nebivolol. It is not only highly selective, it has also, it is also beta-3 agonist. So it blocks beta-1, but it enhances beta-3 activity. Why is this important? Because beta-3 receptors are presented in endothelial cells of coronary arteries, while beta-1 and beta-3 are presented in cardiomyocytes. So here, by acting by agonistic effects on beta-3, it leads to endothelial vasodilatation and improved coronary blood flow in the heart, and on the periphery we have decreased total peripheral vascular resistance, and here we have beneficial effect on contractility and on remodeling. So you can see here effects on nebivolol on heart are related to beta-1 and beta-3, less apoptosis, protection of ischemia, and better contraction. And on the vasculature, we have decreased peripheral vascular resistance, more vasodilatation, and improved endothelial function. It has some effects also on kidney, and there are some reports that nebivolol reduces proteinuria. Then there are some effects on beta-2 receptors in large vessels. It decreases arterial stiffness and pulse wave velocity. And this is the effect I already mentioned of beta-3 on small vascular resistance arteries. It decreases total peripheral resistance. So this was the first one guess. And there are several other guesses which are important for cardiovascular story, and they are interrelated. One is carbon monoxide. The other one is hydrogen sulfide. So it is strange. When I was first faced with this, I remembered what I was taught and what I learned in grammar school about H2S, poisonous gas, about carbon monoxide danger related also to that. So I will speak about H2S. So this is extremely toxic, colorless, flammable, heavier than air, soluble, and it smells or stinks on rotten eggs. So this is its basic characteristic of this gas. It is byproduct formed from when organic matter decays, particularly where is enough sulfur and bacteria presented. And where is the evidence about toxicity of this gas? The first is coming from very past. You can see here for Ediacaran area. At the end of the Ediacaran area, the whole life was destroyed. There is sudden mass extinction of life at the earth, and the main killer was H2S. In fact, they make more place on the earth for later on coming Cambrian explosion. But this is the first evidence about toxic effects of H2S on the earth. The other piece of evidence from the history is coming from 19th century from London, from the workers who cleaned chest poles and others parts of polluted London channels. And what was described that? That this gas injures the health and often extremely dangerous. It's very offensive and often the occasions of serious accidents and even deaths. And the next topic is Great War. The British who invented H2S as a weapon And the first weapon, biological weapon or chemical weapon used in military service was H2S. So here are effects of H2S exposure, odor, irritancy, and at the end, depending on the doses, even death. So potential mechanisms of titotoxicity are very well known. So it killed cells, no question. So H2S or how to survive. And then, 10 years ago, something new appeared. Something new came, something quite opposite. You can see it published in The Scientist, the secret to longer worm's life, a breath of poison gas. In fact, researchers from Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center observed that small quantities of H2S in the air lengthen life in a nematode by 70%. So quite contrary to all what is known before. But this is not all. You can see here, in 1989, H2S was measured in brain. And what is in brain? It must have some physiological purpose. Otherwise, it shouldn't or couldn't be there. And after this, many grants were approved for this. And this is one NIH row one. You can see role of endogenous H2S production in longevity and stress resistance in humans. So NIH could not, will not give money for something what is rubbish. So you can see here what is their hypothesis, that increase in the endogenous production of the gas is essential for these beneficial effects for longevity in human beings. So how this, what are the principles of H2S biology? You can see here H2S is synthesized in brain, but also in the heart, in the lungs, and also we need some help from our neighbors in our gut from microbiota. You can see they help also to increase H2S in our circulation. The most important is L-cysteine. This is the most important step, and there are several pathways which bring us to the H2S in the human bodies. And when we have several pathways, that means this is important. So evolutionarily, we have to have ensured production of H2S. The start is here, methionine, homocysteine, cystatoine, L-cysteine, and then H2S in cells, in mitochondria. So it might be the hyperhomocysteinemia is just epiphenomen of low H2S in our body. And here is the other part from our gut, from microbiota. They also produce H2S, and this H2S also enters the blood flow. There are many data confirming that H2S has beneficial effects. You can see here ischemia reperfusion injury, arrhythmia, cardiac hypertrophy, diabetic cardiomyopathy, heart failure, myocardial fibrosis, and myocardial infarction. All data for all these items. How it was explained, the cardioprotective effects of extremely toxic gas. So it blocks inflammatory cytokines. It enhances NO production. It has beneficial effects on angiogenesis or apoptosis, and it reduces oxidative stress. And related to arrhythmia, it acts on ion channels, it increases potassium and sodium, and decreases calcium channel. Because of that, less arrhythmia we observed with H2S. So the mechanisms of longevity related to H2S are also explained, and only what is missing is the effect of telomere attrition. And very probably it does not have effect, and this effect is not so important. Of course, there is crosstalk between all those gases, between H2S, between NO and CO, and this one part is much more important. H2S increases NO production, and in that way leads to vasodilatation and cardiac protection. So this is normal regulation, normal production, and this is the case when we have this function of production of H2S, and this leads not only to decrease H2S, but to increase homocysteine in our blood. So now the question, Many foods are proposed to have beneficial effect on blood pressure, lowering effect. And you can see here two groups from Google. You can download everything from there. And my question is, where in which food we can find H2S? And in both groups, this fruit or vegetable or anything is present. Garlic, yeah, garlic is this one. So H2S mediates the vasoactivity of garlic. Any data? Yes, published in PNS, that means firm data. But here we have red blood cells. Red blood cells are important. Red blood cells are important for synthesis of H2S from allicin metabolite. Other evidence that there is some beneficial effect on endothelial function? Yes, you can see here. H2S production with garlic leads to vasodilatation. So this is one of explanation and one nice evidence showing that truly a garlic might have antihypertensive effect. But the question is how much garlic should we eat to lower blood pressure? You can see here data published in BMC Cardiovascular Disorders, about 1 gram, in fact. And then the question, how many cloves? And we know more gloves, less kisses. So who will eat a lot of garlic? But the other issue is that the raw garlic only is good. When it's cooked, then its effect is destroyed. And then someone wanted to invent pills, garlic pills. So it might be good, but then how many pills? And we know more pills, less adherence. And then the questions again. What is the feasibility, what will be adherence, what will the price of this, and then it will decrease drug adherence for all other drugs our high-risk patients have to use. It might be used in pre-hypertensive, in low-risk patients, but in high-risk patients, definitely not. So is there any available strategy to increase H2S while treating hypertension? With drugs, now, I'm speaking about high-risk patients. It is said in all guidelines that all antihypertensive drugs lower blood pressure similarly. And this is true. But this is just the tip of the iceberg. They are not the same. They have all different effects on all components of our body. And there are differences within classes. I already shown you some differences with beta blockers. Now I will speak a little bit of ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors are not the same. They are different, quite different. They lower the blood pressure the same. They all have cardioprotective effect. They are good after the stroke, etc. But they are not the same. And then, as the topic of my talk is H2S, what is the difference particularly in the respect to the H2S? Well, the difference between men and women is just in one letter, is the H. Yeah. What about H? And the difference, one of differences among ACE inhibitors or RAS blockers is Mercator group, is HS group. Only two ACE inhibitors contain this group, captopril and zofenopril. And only one sartan has this group, this is omapatrilate. So this is difference between all others. This is structure difference. This is no class effect. This is like losartan has some other differences between compared to other sartans. So what about HS related to ACE inhibitors? So the zofenopril, this ACE inhibitor, is H2S donor. So you can see here these are reds. You can see here Vistar Kyoto reds. They are normotensive reds. They have significantly higher H2S production than spontaneously hypertensive rats. You can see here differences. And then both in aorta and carotid vessel. And then when spontaneously hypertensive rats were treated with enalapril, this is one ACE inhibitor without SH group, and there is no difference from the beginning. But when they are treated with zofenopril, then you can see here that those spontaneously hypertensive rats, which without treatment had less H2S, now have more than Vistar-Kyoto normotensive rats. Both captopril and zofenopril reduce oxidative stress, and there are reports on better endothelial vascular dilatation with sildenafil compared to beta blockers. You can see here. Oops. So I will finish with this. You know this guy very well, Paracelsus, and he says, dosis facit venenum. So everything is in doses, and this explains differences of action of H2S we learned in the past and the beneficial effect we know today. So hypertension is never-ending story. Hypertension is not blood pressure. Hypertension is not five classes of antihypertensive drugs. Hypertension is never-ending battle. And every day we have new weapons in this struggle. And this is the beauty of hypertension. So thank you very much.